Well, hello. My name is Reverend Brian Richards, and we collectively we are.
Hallelujah. For from His fullness we have all received the grace of God, Jesus. The praise of God. If love and joy, the ancient crowns, how precious is my Savior's love. The beauty, the heaven will rock my shame. The image of love upon its frame. If having my heart was worth to pay, what joy could you see beyond the grave? If love found my soul worth dying for, how wonderful, how glorious, my Savior's cross, victorious. My cares are gone, my death is paid, from death to life, and Christ's grace. If heaven now owns that vacant tomb, how great is the hope that lives in you. The passion that tore through hell like a rose. The promise that brought back death and its thorn. If freedom is worth the life you raise, when where is my sin, where is my shame? If love paid it all to have my heart, how wonderful, how glorious, my Savior's cross, victorious. My chains are gone, my death is fade, from death to life. And grace to grace. Because of our sin, He died from the cross. Hallelujah. When I see that grave, I see Jesus. And from death to life, I will sing Your praise. In the wonder of Your grace, when I see the cross, I see freedom. And from death to life, I will sing Your praise. In the wonder of Your grace. In the wonder of Your grace. How wonderful, how glorious, my Savior's cause, victorious. My chains are gone, my debt is paid. and grace to grace. Hey, hey. When I see the cross, I see freedom. When I see that grave, I see Jesus. And from death to life, I will sing your praise. And the wonder of your grace. When I see that grave, I see freedom. And from death to life, I will sing your praise. And the wonder of your grace. How will my soul will sing your praise? My death is paid. From death to life, and grace to grace.
We are the Word of Faith ministers, but when we go to each assembly, we can call ourselves something different. So right here in Sydney, we are the Faith Restoration Church, and our job is to restore again the Tabernacles of David, restore again what was originally given to the Apostolic Church. So we consider ourselves apostolic in nature, and we're here to confirm the Word of God in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Are you bound? Then be free. The Lord says, if you're bound, be free. And who the Lord sets free is free indeed. So if your soul is bound, it can be free today. And I'm thinking about a soul that has escaped out of the clutches of the world and the oppressions that are in the world, that are controlled by the God of this world, which is 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 4 says, the God of this world has blinded the eyes to stop them from seeing the light, the glorious gospel. Now, obviously, that's not the God that we serve. It is the God of this world. So we have two gods now. We have the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, in whom we serve and whom we preach about. But then we have an opposition, a God that tries to blind us from this glorious gospel, which is really a beautiful truth of the Word of God. So I'm going to sing about that my soul has escaped out of the clutches of this other God that's in the world, all right? Soul has escaped as a bird out of the snare of the fowler. My soul has escaped as a bird out of the snare of the fowler. Broken and I have escaped. My help is in the name of the Lord. The snare is broken and I have escaped. My help is in the name of the Lord. One more time. My soul has escaped as a bird out of the snare of the fowler. My soul has escaped as a bird out of the snare of the fowler. The snare is broken and I am escaped. My help is in the name of the Lord. The snare is broken and I am escaped. My help is in the name of the Lord. Yes, my help is in the name. Help is in the name. Help is in the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Yes. So we're going to talk about this God of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the light of the world. And Jesus says, I'm the light that comes into the world, but you are the lights. I am the light that stands on the hill, Jesus says, but you become lights of the world. When you receive Jesus into your life, the light is in you and you become lights to the world. That's what the gospel is all about. That's what the good news, gospel is called good news. And that is the good news, that you can be free from the principalities, the powers, the wicked spirits of darkness. And today is the day of salvation for you and I. As we listen to the word of God being preached, you realize that today you will want to be free, hallelujah, and you receive Jesus as your Lord and Savior. I'm going to get my son Joshua now to come forward and read from us just one chapter of the Bible, which is very, very important, and I'm praying that you will get revelation out of this, get quick understanding, the spirit of counsel and spirit of might. Thank you, Lord, for your word to go forth with power and authority in Jesus' name. Amen. Go.
Hello, my name is Joshua Brian Richards. Today I'm going to be reading from the Living Bible in John chapter 1. Remember to like, comment, subscribe if you're on Vimeo, Daily Motion, or whatever. If you're on YouTube, after subscribing, press the notification bell, and you'll be notified of every time we upload a video. Before anything else existed, there was Christ with God. He has always been alive and is himself God. He created everything there is. Nothing exists that he didn't make. Eternal life is in him, and this life gives light to all mankind. His life is the light that shines through the darkness, and the darkness can never extinguish it. God sent John the Baptist as a witness to the fact that Jesus Christ is the true light. John himself was not the light, he was only a witness to identify it. Later on, the one who is the true light arrived to shine on everyone coming into the world. But although he made the world didn't recognize him when he came. Even in his own land and among his own people, the Jews, he was not accepted. Only a few would welcome and receive him, but to all who received him, he gave the right to become children of God. All they needed to do was trust him to save them. All those who believe this are reborn, not a physical rebirth resulting from human passion or plan, but from the will of God. And Christ became a human being and lived here on earth among us, and was full of loving forgiveness and truth. Some of us have seen his glory, the glory of the only Son of the Heavenly Father. John pointed him out to the people, telling the crowds, this is the one I was talking about when I said someone is coming who is greater by far than I am, for he existed long before I did. We have all benefited from the rich blessings he brought to us, blessing upon blessing heaped upon us. For Moses gave us only the law with its rigid demands and merciless justice, while Jesus Christ brought us loving forgiveness as well. No one has ever actually seen God, but, of course, his only Son has, for he is the companion of the Father and has told us all about him. The Jewish leaders sent priests and assistant priests from Jerusalem to ask John whether he claimed to be the Messiah. He denied it flatly. I am not the Christ, he said. Well then, who are you? They asked. Are you Elijah? No, he replied. Are you the prophet? No. Then who are you? Tell us so we can give an answer to those who sent us. What do you have to say for yourself? He replied, I am a voice from the barren wilderness, shouting as Isaiah prophesied, get ready for the coming of the Lord. Then those who were sent by the Pharisees asked him, if you aren't the Messiah, or Elijah, or the prophet, what right do you have to baptize? John told them, I merely baptized with water, but right here in the crowd is someone you have never met, who will soon begin his ministry among you, and I am not even fit to be his slave. This incident took place at Bethany, a village on the other side of the Jordan River, where John was baptizing. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, "Look, there is the Lamb of God who takes away the world's sin. He is the one I was talking about when I said, 'Soon a man far greater than I am is coming, who existed long before me.' I didn't know he was the one, but I am here baptizing with water in order to point him out to the nation of Israel." Then John told about seeing the Holy Spirit in the form of a dove descending from heaven and resting upon Jesus. "I didn't know he was the one," John said again, "but at the time God sent me to baptize, he told me, 'When you see the Holy Spirit descending and resting upon someone, he is the one you are looking for. He is the one who baptizes with the Holy Spirit. I saw it happen to this man, and I therefore testify he is the Son of God.'" The following day, as John was standing with two of his disciples, Jesus walked by. John looked at him intently and then declared, "See, there is the Lamb of God." Then John's two disciples turned and followed Jesus. Jesus looked around and saw them following. "What do you want?" he asked them. "Sir," they replied, "where do you live?" "Come and see me," he said. So they went with him to the place where he was staying and were with him from about 4 o'clock that afternoon until the evening. One of these men was Andrew, Simon Peter's brother. Andrew then went to find his brother Peter and told him, "We have found the Messiah," and he brought Peter to meet Jesus. Jesus looked intently at Peter for a moment and then said, "You are Simon, John's son, but you shall be called Peter, the Rock." The next day, Jesus decided to go to Galilee. He found Philip and told him, "Come with me." Philip now went off to look for Nathanael and told him, "We have found the Messiah, the very person Moses and the prophets told about. His name is Jesus, the son of Joseph from Nazareth." "Nazareth," exclaimed Nathanael. "Can anything good come from there?" "Come and see for yourself," Philip declared. As they approached, Jesus said, "Here comes an honest man, a true son of Israel." "How do you know what I'm like?" Nathanael demanded. And Jesus replied, "I could see you under the fig tree before Philip found you." Nathanael replied, "Sir, you are the son of God, the king of Israel." Jesus asked him, "Do you believe all this just because I told you I saw you under the fig tree? You will see greater proofs than this. You will even see heaven open and the angels of God coming back and forth to me, the Messiah." That will now come back on.
Well, that's good. I use the King James Bible, and we like to hear from other translations, because then we get a broader picture of what the Bible is actually saying. And some people in some countries, they find it difficult with the King James English, even though it is very good translation, it still confuses some people. So therefore, we are changeable. We preach the King James English, and then we use other ones like the Living Bible to expound. And so be blessed with that interpretation, even though some people say it's a little bit confusing. Well, I know that I started out many years ago, 1982, I think it was, I started in Bible college with a little Bible, and they told me that will change, and it did. Within 2 years, I was reading the King James just like as if I wrote it myself. I understood it that well. But it was God, you see, that used whatever he could at that time to build the anointing into my life. And so you may be new to the Bible and start reading the Bible, and you say, "Oh, well, I'll need to read a Bible that I would understand." And so you will read a Bible that you understand at the beginning, and it could be the Living Bible, as just like I did. But after a short while, you'll realize that in order to remember scriptures, the Lord will use the King James English probably more than any other translation. However, some Americans, they like the NIV and the International Version. And so, you know, it's wherever the Lord will lead you. But the main important part is to have the Spirit of the Lord to lead you and to interpret the Word of God for you. 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15 says study. So that's the most important thing, that you study the Word of God regardless of what translation, and the Lord will lead you to where He wants you to be. Are you a follower then? Are you a believer? Or are you a disciplined disciple of the Lord Jesus Christ? Today may be the first day that you ever heard the Word of God being preached. And you will know that it's different from religion. Religion would never give you a relationship with God. Religion will only give you a set of rules for you to follow to bring some kind of discipline into your life. So we're not preaching religion today. We are preaching relationship through His Word. We acknowledge our Facebook friends, and it is growing. That's great. And we acknowledge YouTube followers, which is approximately 8,000 people scattered throughout the Southeast China Seas, where I've been ministering for a number of years. And we have an increase in America right now with our mailing list, and I haven't investigated to know why that is, but I guess we are in the lucky country, what they call the blessed country. They call it the lucky country of Australia, where we have been enduring the COVID-19. Is it the mm-hmm. disease that has gone around the world? And I guess in Australia we have had some penetration of that, but we've overcome it. And my Prime Minister says that, you know, we're probably the best country in the world that have overcome this disease. It's been the greatest or the biggest attack that the world has ever seen, naturally and spiritually, but we have overcome. And the Lord says in His revelations that if you will overcome, you will be granted to sit with Me on My throne, even as I sit in the Father's throne. Why is all this necessary? Now, you might think, okay, you might be at church for the first time, or you may be listening to me for the first time, and you think, well, I've done all right with this in my life. I don't really need to be listening to this. Well, in the beginning, there was Adam and Eve, and everything was wonderful with Adam and Eve, and God would come and talk to them in the cool of the day, and the relationship was good. Everything was free, didn't have to work for anything, and everything was free, and everything was great. And the Lord, you know, the Spirit of the Lord, God says to Adam and Eve, all the fruit in the garden you can eat, except one. And the tree of good and evil is not meant for you. This tree you don't touch. And so, you know, there was Satan that had been kicked out of heaven through disobedience, and now he becomes the god of this world, still with some of his powers, and not yet stripped of his power and authority of going into heaven and back again, but he's been kicked out of heaven and he doesn't have the job that he had in heaven. In heaven he was the reflector, he was the light reflector. His name was Lucifer, which means light bearer. And now he doesn't carry the light, he's been kicked out of heaven and to earth. And so he realizes that the only way to get the authority back that it lost, the only way to get the power back to what it's lost, and that is to deceive Adam and Eve and become not only the God of this world, but he said, I want to exalt myself to be the Most High God. He wasn't comparing himself to be God himself. And so he knew that the only way to do this was to deceive Adam and Eve and eventually deceive God into bowing, as it were, bowing the authority to satanic forces. And so Lucifer became Satan after he deceived Adam and Eve. You know, always in my own self, I thought to myself, there was maybe a chance for Lucifer to be restored. But after he deceived Adam and Eve, there was no chance. You know, so he tricked Adam and Eve by saying that, how about this tree? The fruit is good. And Eve actually says, we're not allowed to touch that tree. It's the tree of knowledge of good and evil. We're not allowed to touch that tree, but we can eat off all the fruit of the other trees. And he said a half-truth. And he says, God doesn't want you to touch that fruit of that tree because that would make you more like God, more like him. And Eve thought to herself, oh yeah, I want to be more like God. And so Eve was beguiled into taking of the fruit and then gave it to Adam and he took also. So they was tricked, beguiled, deceived, call it what you like, but they was deceived by a half-truth. And that's what Satan does even today, that he deceives people with an element of truth. He can't say a straight-out lie because you know that that is wrong. That's it. What he does, he twists the truth, and a half-truth he would tell you. And so what he said was, half-truth, when Adam and Eve took of the tree of good and evil, they became more like God because God had knowledge of everything that was good, and of course he had knowledge of everything that was evil as well. And it was not necessary for Adam and Eve to be built up in the evil knowledge. Everything was going good with the knowledge of good. As soon as they became knowledge of good and evil, there was a decision to make. And it was a big, you know, big decision. And that was whether to repent and get born again, or whether they're going to live now under the control of Satan, who will become the God of this world. The 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 4, it says that this God now wants to blind the eyes of them to stop them from seeing the light of the glorious gospel. Now, the gospel is the good news of Jesus Christ, and he wants you to deceive you today in not seeing that light. And so Satan has not given up. Even though he's been defeated, he's not given up. He still wants to stop people today from being born again. And how he does that is by a half-truth, by telling you that you've never needed Jesus before, why do you need him now, you see? And the fact is, we can never be like Jesus without being born again. In John chapter 3 and verse 3, you see that Nicodemus, who was a ruler of the Jews, came to Jesus by night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher and you come from God because of the miracles, signs and wonders that follow your ministry." And he said, "Now why is this not happening for me? What am I lacking?" And he says to him, "Marvel not if I say to you, Nicodemus, that you must be born again." He says, "How can I be born a second time?" I'm just paraphrasing this, just so people can understand. He said, "How can I be born a second time? Go into my mother's womb and be born." And he says, "What is flesh, but what is spirit?" And so Jesus was saying, he's talking about a spiritual birth. And he says, just like the wind comes and it goes, you don't see it, but you see. You hear the sound thereof and you see the effects. So is the ways of the Spirit of God, that you must be born again. And so today you will have the Bible in your hand and you can read it along with me, whether it's a paraphrased version like the Living Bible or whether it's the King James Version. You will not fully understand this word until you're born again of the Spirit that actually wrote the book. But men wrote it, yes. Men wrote it, but those inspired by the Spirit of God on what to write. And so it was written by the Spirit of God. And Jesus paid the price for you and I to be restored back to God. Even though we was not the one that committed the first sin, everyone that was born after Adam and Eve had been deceived was born in a state of separation from God. And so you and I, we was born in a state of separation from God. That's why we cannot understand the things of God until we be born again. We need to be, have that separation be made whole. We need to be made whole in order to understand the Spirit of God. We need to be made whole by accepting Jesus into our life to be able to walk away from the alcohol or the drugs or the fornication or the, you know, the sin that so easy besets us. The lust of the eyes, the lust of the flesh, and the pride of man is the basis of all sin. And this sin we need to walk away from because it's going to kill us, not only spiritually but naturally also. How do I know this, Brian? You know, how do I know this? It says in the Bible very clearly that the wages of sin is death. That's in Romans chapter 6 and verse 22 to 23, it talks about the wages of sin is death. All sin, doesn't matter what kind of sin, all sin will lead to death. One little sin leads to another one, a bigger one, and the next time a bigger one, until the sin is that big in your life. It's bigger than life itself. And so you die with the wages of sin is death. But the good news is, it doesn't stop there. The next verse in Romans chapter 6 and verse 22 to 23. In verse 23 says, The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life unto righteousness. And what does righteousness mean? It means you become right standing with God, just like you've never ever sinned, just like Adam and Eve had never ever sinned, just like that separation that we're born with is now made whole. And we become more powerful than we could ever imagine. And it says that in Romans that when we are born again, we receive abundant life. And abundant life is bigger and better. You know, I went to China a few years ago, and in Chinese language, they didn't have a word for being blessed. And they didn't have words like abundance, you know. And so I'm, even with an interpreter, the interpreter was looking at me sort of cross-eyed and with two minds, and he says, "What does that mean?" If I said in China, I want you to be blessed, you have to say things like, "I want you to do better than." You know, see that it sort of waters down the gospel a little bit. But to do better than is the nearest that I could get to being blessed. You know what I mean? They didn't understand the word blessed. They didn't understand the word abundance. But they did understand increase. So I had to change my words in order for them to understand. So that's why we have different interpretations of the Bible. The King James English, they could not understand in China, so we have to take away the things like blessed and put to do better than, and take away the abundance and to put in increase and supernatural increase. And the Bible clearly says that you will exceed abundantly, exceedingly and abundantly more than you hope or think. And that's being blessed. Amen. Father God, I just pray that we can be blessed today, that we can receive life abundance, that we can receive your Spirit into our life exceedingly and abundantly, that we can receive forgiveness where we've walked away from you, and where we've walked away from the good news of the gospel, and we've walked our own way. We repent of that. We ask you to forgive us for that, Lord God. Give us the understanding once again what it is to be born again, to be filled with your Spirit, not the Spirit that is in the world, not the Spirit that is in my flesh, but the Spirit of God coming into my soul will make me saved, make me healed, and make me like you, Lord God. Let the light of your word come into my heart, come into my brain, and give me the mind of Christ. I pray in Jesus' name. If that's your desire also, then you say this prayer with me. Heavenly Father, I believe in Jesus.
I believe in Jesus.
I believe Jesus died on the cross of Calvary.
I believe Jesus died on the cross of Calvary.
And rose again from the dead.
And rose again from the dead.
And I accept him as my Lord.
And I accept him as my Lord.
And my Savior.
And my Savior.
My healer.
My healer.
And my deliverer.
And my deliverer.
I thank you, Lord, because I believe I receive.
I thank you, Lord, because I believe and I receive.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen. Now, that prayer said in a sincere heart will make you born again. Not only be born again, but it fill you with your Spirit, fill you with the Spirit of God, and you have a life-changing experience through knowing Jesus and the Word are one. Joshua just read out of the John chapter 1. But in the King James it says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. And you've just received this Word that is comes into your life, into your brain, into your body, into your spirit and soul, and makes you born again. Amen. Now you need to be baptized. And what is baptized? Is being dunked in the water, get wet all over, and it's not just an outward expression of an inward witness. It is more than that. God actually do an operation in the waters of baptism by faith. You can receive a life-changing experience in the waters of baptism. God does a circumcision, a cutting away of the old man, of the old nature, and you'll be free. Who the Lord sets free is free indeed, in Jesus' name. And you'll be born again, and you'll be filled with the Spirit of God. We're going to sing a song about being born again. And the things that I've mentioned so far, if you think to yourself that you would like to be born again, you'd like to experience what I've been talking about, that prayer is still available for you now. Receive me, Lord. I know that I'm a sinner, and I want to be born again. Help me, Lord God. I commit my works to you. Give me your mind in Jesus' name. Any prayer like this, that is a surrender to God, is a born-again prayer, and that will give you a life-changing experience through knowing Jesus and the Word are one. Say that with me. Jesus and the Word are one. We're going to sing this. With
Can you please connect?
My right.
Connect.
This is my wife. Okay. If you haven't seen Erlinet before, this is Erlinet Kizo Richards.
Yeah.
And she does all the good singing around here. She's going to have, she has her own channel, of course, the Craft Channel.
Yeah.
And you can see all this on the internet.
Very soon, I'm going to make a channel, introduce all my craft.
Lots of artwork. Yeah.
Made of toilet roll, bottle. This is made of bottle, put together inside this rice. So we call this rice shaker.
Rice shaker, yeah. And
behind me is a toilet roll.
God
is love.
Hallelujah.
With cardboard. So I never throw everything. I just make.
So the artwork is to the glory of God. So
yes.
Everything is done to the glory of God. And so now we're going to sing about being born again. Are we ready?
Born again. Come give me your sweetness. Tell us your needs. Lie safe within your arms. I'm born again. I was not. Oh, instead with none, reaching through this world in need of one.
Come show me your kindness. In your arms I know I'm finally. Woman, don't you know with you I'm born again?
Lying safe with you I'm born again. Comfort me through all this madness.
Woman, don't you know it's you? I'm born again.
Come give me all sweetness. Lovers, you, there is no weakness. Lying safe within your arms, I'm born again. I was not a instead with none, reaching to the world in need of one. Come show me your kindness, in your arms I know I'll find this.
Woman, don't you know it's you? I'm born again.
Lying safe with you, I'm born again.
Hello. You know why we sing this song? Because we're gonna be celebrating our 17th wedding anniversary on Thursday. Yay!
Hallelujah!
And maybe we can, we are not confirmed yet, but maybe we can celebrate a small celebration because of this COVID, you know. There are lots of until now restrictions. So maybe a small celebration with our my friends.
Yeah, so if you're local, come.
We cannot celebrate everybody, but if you feel to visit us, but we're gonna celebrate on Saturday because we have friends, special friends that from Liverpool will come here on Saturday. They are able to come Saturday. Yeah. They cannot come on Thursday because they are working. So we're gonna, if you cannot come here, if you can, if you are willing to come and celebrate us, you're welcome.
Okay. So put your microphone back there. You got a testimony.
Yes, I'm gonna.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah. I have. If you miss this, because maybe we just small celebration, but I have to give you my testimony in my life.
Oh, okay.
With Brian and me.
Oh, thank you.
You want me to do? Okay.
That's good for
you. Okay. So. I give you a testimony in our lives. For 17 years, I could not imagine, you know. I really love this man. This man, you know, I met this man in my grandmother's church in 2003. Oh, you know what? I never have an idea that he was doing a missionary work there for about 10 years before I met him.
Yes.
10 years, right?
Yes.
So when I met him, actually my grandmother introduced me. This is my granddaughter. And you said what?
I haven't seen this woman before. And she says, well, I don't go to this church. And she was selling Avon.
Yeah, I used to be Avon representative before in Dumaguete. And then I went to my grandmother's church because they ordered me Avon, you know. But I go there sometimes only because I went to the church, UCCP, United Church of Christ.
I thought I could get some aftershave. Yes.
And then I tried to escape him, actually. I said, no, I never have a dream to marry a white Americano, a white man. No. And then I left something there. So I went back there and just, he's been there. I'm still there. I still hear this man. And then he said, can you give me your mobile phone number?
Yeah.
That's the beginning. Wow. Yeah. That's the beginning. And then, you know, that's the beginning of our friendship. And then he called me and he said, can we have a date? You know, I wanna know you. And I go, uncle, okay. And then after 3 days,
yes.
After 3 days, he proposed me. Oh my God, I was shocked. He proposed me, and then when he really talked to my parents, and he's willing to marry me. You know that. And then before that, I called my sister, the youngest sister, And I said to her, Joy, I met this man, Americano Joy. We call in Philippines Americano, you know. He's a missionary, Joy. And then, you know what? He is willing to marry me. What? You just met Enrico? Yeah, after 3 days, he asked me, would you like to marry me? And I said, oh, let me think about that. And my sister said, don't think about that, grab the opportunity. Because at that time, at that time, I was 35 years old, you know, I'm old maid already. I'm in Philippines, we call that olay. Oh my God, olay na. I was, for some reason, I never, 10 years before I met Ryan, I never have any boyfriend, and for some reason, you know. So I grabbed the opportunity, and my sister said to me, Mai, I think this is the last trip. This is your last trip, grab the opportunity, said yes, because maybe if said no, nobody marry you anymore. So I'm worried about that. She go, yeah, you give me an idea, Joy. maybe this is my last, you know. So when he came up to me again and said to me, what do you think? What is your decision? And he said, I made my decision. Yes. So, and you know what? When he showed me the resume. What is my attractive? He's a marriage celebrant, you know, and he's a pastor too and missionary. So I attracted with that. I thought to myself, oh, maybe this is God gave it to me. He go, oh, this is my answered prayers. Go, and I'm thinking about marriage celebrant. Oh. He can do a wedding anywhere. And then I thought to myself, if I marry this man, maybe I sing a song during wedding day, you know? So my dreams came true, because when I married him, so far, when Brian did a wedding, maybe 12 couple already, right? Since so far, I sing a song, you know? So my dream come true, wow! So I give thanks to the Lord, you know? I think God has a purpose why I married this man, because my life was totally changed, you know, and my belief too is different before. And then for me, he's a very good preacher for me, you know. He learned a lot. He has more knowledge about the Word of God, and the more on he showed me, you know, and a lot of miracles in my life. When I got married with Brian, I became anointed. Because he's anointed, you know. He has a gift of healing, he has a gift of a prophecy. I think he's a good man for me, you know. Lots of people hate his guts, really. to be honest, lots of people hate his guts, but for me, he's a good man for me. He changed a lot of people, you know, and I amazed with him when we did a missionary work for 2015. And at the time, we visited only my father because he was so sick, and we did never do anything. And my sister is a leader of missionary, like a prisoner missionary team, missionary, and she was invited us to go there, but not to do anything, because, you know, that's why I told you that we're visiting only there. So we went to one of the prisoners in Dumaguete. I don't want to mention. So we went there, and then Brian give a short preaching only, you know, and I sing a song, just because we are not really my sister and the other with a pastor there, you know. So we just give a few song and a few message from Brian, and you know what? After that, two prisoners really running, you know, come running, asking help for us. And then, hello, sir, mom, before you go, please help us. We are really sleeping on concrete floor, mom. We need banig, mom. Can you help me, mom? And they are crying, you know. And Brian said, what they're talking about? I didn't understand these people. So I tried to explain, Brian, they want us help. They need sleeping mats because they sleep in concrete floor. And Brian said, oh, And Brent said, really, look at these people. That I really wish to help you guys, but this time we cannot help you. Because we come here to visit my father, you know, we come here to visit. We cannot help you guys, sorry. But we won't promise you, but maybe we can help you someday, you know. And then when, okay, sir, we understand you, sir. And then when he left, when we got back here, Brian couldn't, he couldn't sleep, you know. He's always, Erlinet, we do something for these people, Erlinet. I couldn't sleep. I always dream with these people. They're, help me, help me, help me. And I said, Ningo, okay, what we gonna do, Brian? What we gonna do? He said, we do something. So when I learned ukulele, and then it's like, sounds good already before, you know, that was 3 years ago. 4 years ago, Brian. So I tried to make a CD, like a recording. So I'm recording maybe 12 songs, you know, I'm recording. And then I told to Brian, Brian, I think this is good enough for visiting some churches, you know, and maybe we ask help to our friend pastor in Sydney before when we wasn't there, moved here in Sydney. So maybe we can do something, Brian. We can ask a donation for this so that we can give sleeping mats, because they need 400 sleeping mats, you know what I mean. So we're recording, and then we are, before we went back to Philippines, that was another 2 years before that. And then we asked pastor, a friend, a pastor in Sydney, can we visit your church? And can we visit somewhere so then we can ask, we can buy a sleeping mat for this prisoner in Philippines, because we have a plan to go back to Philippines and do missionary work and visit my parents there. So that's what our vision, you know. And then we pray that, Lord, if this is your will, Lord, you can make a way for us, Lord. So we went to visit some churches here in Sydney, and they give us donation, my CDs. We made 100 CDs, and then they give us $50, $20 on it. Wow, we have money. When we went back to Candletown, we have money. And some of our friend also from Tasmania, he gave us money also too. Enough and to give this 400 sleeping mats. That's wonderful, you know what I mean? And then, you know what, why I told you this? Because of Brian's, he has a big heart. He has a passion to give something to those poor people, you know. And at the time, I fell in love with him, very much, because I never realized that he has a big heart. He has compassion to those, especially in prisoners, you know. And thank God, we did it. We did it. I could not imagine, you know. My life was totally changed when I married with my husband. And you know what? I said to him, I'm very proud of you, because you have a lots of gifts of prophecy, like that God give lots of gifts of, you know, the fivefold gifts that I've learned from Brian. He said to me that gifts of prophecy, gifts of gifts of teaching, gifts of evangelism, gifts of pastor. That's a fivefold ministry, and that gifts is for me. He has a fivefold gifts, really. You know, he's a prophet for me. If I will tell you something, I think I can use maybe an hour to tell you everything about my husband. But I would like to tell you, I'm very proud of him. You know, he's an author. He's a writer. He's an author. He can play guitar. He doesn't know about the chords, but he can play. Could you imagine that? I thought to myself, he should be a deserved to get an award by there, but nobody recognized him. But God is really recognized him, and I recognize him. I'm very proud of him, you know. People hate him, but I love him so much because he is very good. He's a good man. He changed people's lives. So that's my testimony in my life. And if you are willing to come here to celebrate our wedding anniversary, your friend here in Sydney, You are welcome. Bring your plate. You are welcome, my friend, if you want to come here and to know more about Brian and me. We can do something more, you know, we can share about our missionary work, or how life changed our lives, you know. You know, I believe that if you are married, Jesus is the center of your relationship, you know. I cannot imagine 17 years we've been together now. Well, I was struggling, especially his accent before, you know. And God helped me to educate myself, helped me to learn more how to speak English well, you know. I've done 510 hours to learn good grammar so that I can communicate him well. Thank God. Not perfect, but our relationship is getting better. Our communication is getting better because I went to TAFE learning English. I've done three courses, including the Philippines secretarial. And then here is children's services. I did assistant nursing, and then I did try the lifestyle, and then I think I want to go on with this to get a proper job in the future. So thank God, because of God's favor, His love, we've been together. I love this one. I really love this. Thank you, and Brian would tell.
I just want to share with you this book. My latest book is called Are You in Christ? Probably the wrong colors to show right there. But in red it says Are You in Christ? And so that's a question for all of us. Are you in Christ? Even the ones who think that in Christ, they need to have a look at this book. Christ is not Jesus' second name. Lots of people, they think Jesus Christ, and Christ is second name for Jesus. Some people say, well, Jesus didn't have a second name. Christ means the anointing that was on Jesus, or the anointed one, which was Jesus. And so when we say Christ, we talk about the anointing or the anointed one. And several times, if you want to get revelation knowledge, read your Bible, and everywhere it says Christ, you turn it into the anointing. Okay? The anointing. Everywhere you see Christ in your Bible, think anointing. And you'll be surprised what happens to you. Your whole life, whole mind, soul, spirit will change, and change your body to be healed, change your mind to be the mind of Christ, and it changes your soul. Your whole being will change because you understand who Christ is and how it affects the whole understanding of the Bible will be affected when you meditate on Christ being the anointed one. And this book is talking about, all the way through, is talking about Christ, talking about being born again. It's talking about lots of things that we've originally heard in the Bible that are not being preached today. And the number one thing that I'm big on in preaching, and that is the water baptism. Some people don't realize how water baptism is so vital for salvation. And there's many people that get born again experience, they have a born again experience, but they're not baptized correctly. Some people think, I was baptized as a baby, so I've been baptized all my life, all my adult life, I've been baptized right from a baby. And that's why I go to church today, because I've been, as a baby, was baptized. Well, there's nowhere in the Bible that says that they can baptize a baby. And the only place in the Bible where they come close to baptizing the baby was a child dedication. Anna, when she prayed for a child, and when she got the child, she offered it up to the Lord, and they anointed the head of the child with water, signifying the life. You know, you can't, water is what represents the life. And so when we dedicate a child to the Lord, we use water, for the water is life. And but that's not a baptism, because the Bible is very clear. It says that if you believe and are baptized, you shall be saved. That's in Mark 15:16. It says, those that believe and are baptized shall be saved. And then it goes on a little bit further. It says, and those that are not baptized shall be damned. Now, I didn't know what damned means until my son looked it up. And I was saying, well, damned would mean the opposite to being saved, you know. I thought that's a reasonable assumption. And my son looked it up on Google, you know, and damned means that you not only saved, but you go to hell without being saved. So it tells you very clear on Google. So you must be born again, Jesus says, but also it does say that you must be baptized. You that believe and are baptized shall be saved. And there are lots of people still in churches today that are considered themselves Christian, and yet they're not water baptized correctly. When I say correctly, I mean the full immersion baptism, not just a little sprinkle as a baby. And I also mean that if you haven't been baptized in Jesus' name, then you're not filled with the Holy Spirit either. Oh, but I've been baptized and I'm talking in tongues and all of that, yeah. So I'm spirit filled. Not necessarily. The Bible clearly says that you must be born again, you must be baptized, and if you're not baptized in Jesus' name, then you have received repentance only, but you're not filled with the Holy Spirit. The Word of God says very clearly that in Acts 19, there was the Apostle Paul and Apollos preaching on the coasts of Ephesus, and they went into Ephesus and they said, there's people that received Jesus, we want to congratulate them. And they said, have you received, Paul said, have you received the Holy Ghost since you believe? And they said, we not so much have heard there be any Holy Ghost to be given, you know. And they said, well, straight away related it to water baptism. And he said, well, in whose name or what name was you baptizing? And they said, we was baptized according to John the Baptist. Now that must be good. John the Baptist was the one who preached before Jesus came. And he actually said that there's one coming after me that I'm not worthy to unloose his sandals. And he will baptize with the Holy Spirit and with fire. So they said, well, we was baptized according to John the Baptist. And Paul and Apollos, they said, well, that's good for repentance, but if you want to receive the Holy Spirit, you must be baptized in Jesus' name. So they was baptized a second time and filled with the Holy Ghost, and demonic influences was cast out of them. I would say religious spirits was cast out of them, because they would believe in their religion but not the Word of God. But now you look at the Word of God, and we are talking about relationship. We're not talking about religion. Now, religion would teach you all the these and thous, and it teach you all the Ten Commandments, and the Ten Commandments was only meant to be a schoolmaster to lead us into Christ, lead us into this anointing of Christ. And so the Ten Commandments was just a schoolmaster for you to be in Christ. If you be in Christ, then you're Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. What promise? Well, you look at all the promises in Deuteronomy 28, the first 14 verses are talking about the promises that you can receive by faith. And if you've been born again, and if you're in Christ, then you're Abraham's seed and heirs according to the promise. And the promise is that you've been delivered from the curse. In Galatians 3:13, he says, cursed is a man that hangeth on a tree, and that was Jesus, hung on a tree for you and me to be free from the curse. And it says that we are redeemed from the curse, Galatians 3:13. We are redeemed from the curse. And so in Deuteronomy 28, it talks about the blessings. The first 14 verses are blessings. The rest of the chapter is talking about the curse that does not relate to you, because you are redeemed from the curse by being in Jesus Christ. By being baptized into Jesus' name, you receive the anointing that will make you redeemed from the curse. If you are born again today and you're still receiving, you still have problems in your life, it's because you're not baptized in Jesus' name. If you're baptized in Jesus' name, you can cast out devils, cast out demonic influences, cast out the smoking, the alcohol, the fornication, all the sins that were so easy beset you in times past. You'll be free in Jesus' name by being baptized in Jesus' name. Amen. If you're not baptized in Jesus' name, then you've been granted repentance, okay? And who's to say whether you're saved or not? Only God knows. He's the judge, not me. But according to the Word of God, if you are talking in tongues, it's only a sign of repentance. If you've been baptized in Jesus' name, you not only will talk in tongues, you'll have the fruit of the Holy Spirit, and you have the evidence of the fruit of the Holy Spirit. And you have the fivefold ministry gifts, the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher, the gifts of the Holy Spirit. Them are the ascension gifts, and then there's many other gifts that of the Holy Spirit that will manifest in your life. Words of knowledge, words of prophecy, words of edification, exhortation and comfort. You have this knowledge that only the Lord can give you in Christ. Are you in Christ today? Are you in Christ? This is free for everybody on my mailing list. If you're not on my mailing list, get on, even if it's just to get the book. You can unsubscribe later, it doesn't matter. I have 8,000 people on the mailing list. I've been saying that for a long time. It's probably more like 10,000 by now. But they're not all together, you see. They're all of, I got followers on liking, followers on the YouTube, and followers on Facebook. So it's more like 10,000 now, you know. I've been saying 8,000 for a long time, more like 10,000 now. But be on the mailing list and receive this book totally free. I can only do it by electronic download. But if you want this book, the hard copy book, then you go to trafficbuilder2.com and you'll see that book that you can order and be delivered right to your door. Doesn't matter where you are in the world, this is free delivery with that price in Jesus' name. Amen. So we're going to close now, and I'm going to pray again for those people that receive this word. The Apostle Paul prayed a prayer. I'm going to pray for you now. In Romans chapter 1 and verse 11, he says, I desire to be with you that I may impart unto you some spiritual gift to the end that you'd be established. So say this prayer with me. Heavenly Father,
Heavenly Father,
I believe in Jesus.
I believe in Jesus.
I believe Jesus rose again from the dead.
I believe Jesus rose again from the dead.
I accept him as my Lord.
I accept as my Lord.
And my Savior.
And my Savior.
Come into my heart now.
Come into my heart.
Make me born again.
Make me born again.
And filled with your Spirit.
And filled with your Spirit.
I believe.
I believe.
That I receive.
That I receive.
Right now.
Right now.
The Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit.
And spiritual gifts.
And the spiritual gifts.
To the end that I would be established.
To the end of established.
In ministry.
In ministry,
in salvation, healing, and deliverance. In Jesus' name, I pray.
Amen.
So, if you pray with me today, I'd like to know. You can send me an email. The email will be on the screen. Send me an email. Send me your prayer request. And if you'd be led to give a love gift, we'd appreciate that also. Anybody who wants to join us on our evangelism, even in Australia or in other countries, wherever, you be on our main list. Come and say hello to me. We thank you for being here today. Continue to pray.